Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. I hope you're doing well. Today I'm going to talk about the Consumer Protection Act of 2019 and what are the major changes that have been brought about in Consumer Protection Act and how different consumer rights have been added, what is the appeal looking like, what is the litigation cost now involved. All of these very different aspects of Consumer Protection Act is what I'm going to discuss today. So let us try and explore exactly what is the definition of consumer under the new Consumer Protection Act and what are the different rights which have been given to a consumer. To begin with, consumer has been defined under Section 27 of the Consumer Protection Act 2019, and it covers for the first time transactions through all modes, which includes offline and online, through electronic means, teleshopping, multi-level marketing, or direct selling. So e-commerce has actually come under the purview of what is called as direct selling. The money that is spent on buying product till that time will determine the value of the case, as opposed to earlier parameter of total value of purchased goods or services. This basically means that earlier, where we were only looking at the value of the purchased goods and services, now it is also the time value of money which has been bought under this definition. Also, we see that consumer can file complaint from anywhere across India. Earlier, the position of law was that a complaint had to be filed wherever the registered office of the opposite party was, which basically meant that the seller, if was a seller was located in, let's say, Bangalore, and the buyer was located in Delhi, they had to file it in Bangalore. However, that position has completely been changed now, and what has come about is that the complainant can file complaint sitting anywhere in the country, and e-filing of complaint has become the new norm of the day. Moving forward, we shall see what is the definition of complaints under Section 2, Subclause 6 of the Consumer Protection Act, and what all has been included in this. Primarily, we see that e-commerce companies have been brought under the purview, and therefore we see unfair contracts have been included, unfair trade practices have been included, restrictive trade practice which is adopted by a trader or a service provider has been included, and a complaint can be filed against these. Goods which suffer one or more defects, services which suffer some kind of a deficiency, a complaint can be filed under this section as far as that goes. Price charged for goods or services in excess of prices fixed by law, or displayed on goods or packages, displayed on price list, or agreed between two parties. If there is a variation in that, then that can also come under the Section 2, Subclause 6 of the Consumer Protection Act. We also see that goods and services which are seen to be hazardous to life and safety, and which are offered for sale to the public, have also been bought under this section, and a complaint can be registered against that. Claim for product liability action lies against product manufacturers, product sellers, and product service provider, which essentially means that any product liability, if there is any injury maybe which is caused out of a product, then that injury also is required to be compensated. A practical example could be, for example, taking a pressure cooker. If somebody buys a pressure cooker and that pressure cooker bursts, earlier the provision was that the seller would only pay for the pressure cooker, the value of the pressure cooker. But now the compensation arising as a result of the injury inflicted due to the defective pressure cooker is also covered under this Act. Rights have been defined under Section 2, Subclause 9 of the Act. Here, the discussion is primarily on what all rights have been included, and from the previous rights which were already provided under Consumer Protection Act 1986. Now, right to be protected against goods or services which are hazardous to life and property. Right to information about quality, quantity, potency, purity, standard, price of goods, products or services, protecting consumers against unfair trade practice has been included. Right to be assured of access to variety of products or services at competitive prices. This primarily means that when there is an online store, let's say an e-commerce platform, and then there is a brick and mortar store, any price point, the competitive price point should be the same, and that it should not vary in terms of a different platform being used. So for example, if I can buy a mug for X rupees, I should be able to purchase that same mug for X rupees across different platforms, be it a brick and mortar store or an online platform. Similarly, right to seek redressal against unfair trade practice or restrictive practices and exploitation of consumer. Right to be heard in consideration of consumer's interest at appropriate fora should be redressed. That again is another right that has been given. And right to consumer awareness, which was already there, has also been included in the latest Consumer Protection Act. Now, very interestingly, what they've done is they've introduced a chapter which is called as Chapter 3, and Section 10 onwards, Central Consumer Protection Authority has been appointed. This will be set up by the central government to promote, protect, and enforce rights of consumer. So matters related to violation of consumer rights, unfair trade practices, misleading advertisements will all be looked after by the CCPA. And CCPA will for the first time have an investigating wing, which will be headed by a director general, and they will conduct inquiry or investigation into such violations. So this will also help in, you know, passing of orders for recall of goods or withdraw services which may be hazardous, reimbursement of prices which have been paid, discontinuation of unfair trade practices. This will also fundamentally inquire into violation of consumer rights, investigating and launching prosecution at appropriate forum. I think this is key, because CCPA will then be launching prosecution. Also, the issuing of directions to traders, manufacturers, advertisers, publishers to discontinue false advertisements. They will also be responsible for imposing penalties, and they will also issue safety notices to consumers against unsafe goods and services. So these functions of CCPA will definitely go a very long way, and I think it has very interestingly imposed these penalties. They can impose a penalty of up to rupees 10 lakh and imprisonment of up to 2 years for false or misleading advertisement. And in the event of a subsequent offence, they can put in rupees 50 lakh as a penalty and imprisonment of up to 5 years. They can also prohibit the product or service for a period of up to 1 year, and for subsequent offences, they can extend it by 3 years. These penalties have been defined under Section 20 and 21. And any appeal against these orders will go to the National Commission, where an appeal must be filed within 30 days of the receiving of such an order under Section 24 of the Act. Moving forward, I think what is of real importance is to see how e-commerce has been brought under the radar of CPA, and there are rules which have been drafted which are available on the Consumer Department's website, which is available for all to see. And the Act primarily says that e-commerce will be governed by laws that apply to direct selling. Platforms will have to disclose their addresses, website, email, and other conditions related to refund, exchange, terms of contract, and warranty on their website. We've also experienced so many times that we may have ordered an X product and we receive a fake or a counterfeit product from an e-commerce portal. So in case of counterfeit products being sold or delivered, the company will be penalized. And so many times we see that there are unfair contracts that we have to enter, which may be just a one-sided contract, and completely illegal in that sense. Any such unfair contract will then, the consumer can file a complaint and challenge such unfair and arbitrary contracts. I think this is a good way forward. Interestingly, what they've also seen is that they've made it mandatory that a grievance officer should be appointed for these e-commerce platforms, and any complaint which comes has to be resolved within 1 month of receiving of such a complaint. So this is a huge step forward as far as e-commerce portals are concerned. Moving forward, the jurisdiction of consumer dispute resolution commissions, the pecuniary jurisdiction especially has been increased. So earlier, where a consumer had to come all the way to National Commission in order to file a matter for any amount above 1 crore rupees, can now file that complaint at the district consumer commission, because there they can have the resolution of the case within 3 months, as has been stipulated, and in case there is any inquiry, then within 5 months. For state commissions, the pecuniary jurisdiction has been improved. It has gone from 1 crore to 10 crore, and for national commission it has been over rupees 10 crores. Appeals of course will come to national commission. This will be on the basis of value of goods and services as on the date of filing of the case. So primarily it will include the amount escalated in terms of interest cost as far as the amount that we have invested is concerned, the time value of money is concerned. Complaints. So we, as we know, any appeal from National Commission will then go to Supreme Court. Very interestingly, for the first time, we see that an alternate dispute resolution mechanism has been added. Under Section 75 of the Act, mediation for the first time has been added. Even though hitherto there were instances where out-of-court settlements would take place, but now mediation has been brought under the Act, and mediation cells will be made in the district, state and national commissions. So agreement has, any settlement agreement which is arrived at will have to be reduced to writing and signed by the parties. If an agreement is arrived only about a specific part, then that can also be undertaken, and the rest of the dispute can then be adjudicated as per the forum. And in case no agreement is reached, then in that situation, a report has to be sent by the mediator to the concerned commission. I would also like to add a few of miscellaneous provisions which have been added. An appeal which earlier could be filed at an amount of 25,000 or 35,000 rupees. Now any such appeal can only be filed when there is a depositing of 50% of the amount which has been awarded. This will, at one step we will see that this will definitely increase the litigation cost. However, we also see that this will keep frivolous litigation at bay, and we will not see flooding of the commission. We will also see that product liability will definitely mean that consumers have right to seek compensation for any harm which is caused to them. Consumers can seek hearing through video conferencing. This is to facilitate that a consumer can fight their own case if they want to, without engaging a lawyer. And also unfair trade practices, the paradigm or the definition of unfair trade practice has been increased, where failure to issue bills or receipt has been included. Refusal to accept returned goods within 30 days is considered to be an unfair trade practice. Disclosure of personal information given unless required by law or in public interest is again an unfair trade practice. However, contests and lotteries have been excluded from the broader definition. I think this will give you a bird's eye view of what primarily the Consumer Protection Act 2019 envisages. The Act has been notified, however, the rules are yet to be notified. We will still have to wait and watch about the rules and how they pan out. But this is a very brilliant and a positive step forward. I hope you like my presentation today, and please do like my videos and subscribe to my channel. Thank you so much for watching, and have a nice day.